thank you for having me. Let me get this going. I'm Meredith Busch, like you said, and today we'll talk about Presbyterian anti-communism, which took the form of both opposition to Marxism and McCarthyism. Although American anti-communism dates back to the earliest Marxism, socialists and communists were considered marginal for many years, making American communism a benign affliction of some cadres of Americans. Communists, socialists, and the majority of Americans found it possible and even beneficial to unite against fascism originally, which was the more pressing threat in the 1930s and throughout World War II. But with the close of the Second World War and the defeat of fascism, Soviet-American tension grew out of the former alliance, and the Cold War created a rift between socialism, communism, and American capitalist democracy. During that period, America also experienced a huge resurgence in Christian faith, characterized by the growth of traditional denominations like Methodist, Baptist, Disciples of Christ, Lutheran, and Presbyterian. There was a boom in the building of churches and increased Bible sales. And in that atmosphere, there ensued an ideological battle that still rages on today, a conflict between Christian American democracy and godless communism. The growing threat of the Soviet Union and the increasingly prevalent perception that non-believers were anti-American created the perfect breeding ground for Christian anti-communism. And that perception was perpetuated by President-elect Dwight Eisenhower in 1952, when he said, "Our form of government has no sense unless it is founded in a deeply felt religious faith, and I don't care what it is." This united Protestants of different sects and denominations, along with the Catholic Church and those of the Jewish faith, in the shared belief that the non-religious, whether atheist or socialist, were not only un-American, but anti-American, was the beginning of that idea of the Judeo-Christian America. Marxism at its core, atheistic and anti-religious, which was considered both un-American and anti-American, especially given the prevalence of Christian heritage throughout history, especially as it was constructed at that post-war period. So just to kind of set a baseline, in the manifesto of the Communist Party, Marx and Engels wrote, "Communism abolishes eternal truths. It abolishes all religion and all morality. Instead of constituting them on a new basis, it therefore acts in contradiction to all past historical experience." Engels goes further in his drafted A Communist Confession of Faith to say that all religions which have existed hitherto were expressions of historical stages of development in, of individual peoples or groups of peoples, but communism is that stage of historical development which makes all existing religions superfluous and supersedes them. But in practice, communist countries and communist parties around the world took different approaches in their opposition to religion. And Earl Browder, the one-time leader of the Communist Party of the United States, wrote in a publication called What is Communism? That in working with these masses, talking about the United Front when the Communist Party aligned itself with regular leftist politics, communists take their religious beliefs into account. We respect these beliefs. This does not mean that we cease to regard religion as a capitalist-controlled institution, but we do respect the right of the masses to hold on to their views and are entirely opposed to any system of coercion, such as the fascists in Germany are trying to impose upon Protestants and Catholics. So Browder would later elaborate on the beliefs of communism and how they relate to freedom of religion and the separation of church and state in his subsequent publication, Religion and Communism. He wrote that in what he described as a response to an extensive newspaper campaign being conducted in the United States designed to unite all persons of religious belief in a common front against communism on the ground that communism and the communists threatened to destroy their religions and their religious freedom. While Browder continually asserted that in Marxian materialism, religion is minimized as the opiate for the masses, he strives to set straight the religious affront that communism will actively abolish all religions. We've all seen how it plays out, but this was Browder's idea at the time. At the same time, he continually proves the point of religious opponents, explaining that communism will fill the need for religion when he tries to inculcate his readers. That newspaper campaign took many forms. In fact, there were one of the articles explained the efforts to resist godless communism and set the tone in a 1954 Gallup poll, which released figures explaining the increase of church going, demonstrating that 30% of those polled increased attendance due to fear, unrest, and uncertainty of the future. In a response, Edward W. Barrett proposed a solution to that fear when he wrote an open letter to religious leaders in The Sun, calling for interfaith cooperation against the evils of communism, stating, "It is time for religious leaders to de-emphasize their differences and to join in focusing world attention on the remarkable amount of agreement among the faiths, as opposed to the godless dogma of world communism. This effort to undermine communism took many forms, depending on denomination and subdenomination." And this paper explores the attitudes toward Cold War communism in the Soviet Union from within a single denomination, Presbyterianism, obviously. Within the wider historiography of anti-communism and communism in America, the majority of the literature is rooted in Soviet espionage, McCarthyism, CPUSA politics and leadership, the labor movement and the civil rights movement. There are a few biographies and a few publications on Christianity and the Cold War, but little research has been done in this for this post-war period, particularly at the denominational level. So this research paper seeks to fill that void, hopefully partially, by investigating anti-communist attitudes of Presbyterians during those first 20 years of the Cold War. The research focuses on prominent Presbyterian figures whose attitudes were made public and influenced followers, including preachers like Carl McIntyre, Eugene Carson Blake, and Edward Ensign, other public figures like Dwight Eisenhower and John Foster Dulles, and contributors to religious publications like the Presbyterian Guardian. Because the attitudes towards socialism were likely to emulate their other perspectives on church doctrine and their general worldviews, I separated the thought leaders according to their subdenominational associations. And for this paper, looked at the Presbyterian Church of the in the United States of America, the PCUSA, the Orthodox Presbyterian Church, the OPC, and the Bible Presbyterian Church, along with some spinoff Columbus Synod. There's so many spinoffs. After analyzing the attitudes in detail, I kind of identified a few common themes and extricated the more controversial and marginal ideas to get an idea of the spectrum of Presbyterian attitudes at the time. So the more commonly held attitudes, some of them espoused stronger ideas like Carl McIntyre, but three attitudes were consistent throughout all of the literature and that I looked at. Communism is an evil, but Christians should still love its believers and citizens as Christ would. Two, Christians and the church must work to fight communism both at home and abroad. And three, Christians should guard their hearts against communism's penetrating ideology, as well as the vigilantism that could foster fascism in the event of communist defeat. The Presbyterian denomination was home to individuals evincing a wide variety of attitudes, but some of them utilized a more extreme invective when denouncing Marxist ideology, the communist leaders, and the constituents of those nations. And so we'll take a look at each subdenomination, beginning with the Presbyterian Church in the United States of America. It's the largest subdenomination of the Presbyterian Church at the time, and it was consequently home to the majority of influential Presbyterian thought leaders, one of them being President Eisenhower. In 1953, at the urging of Reverend Billy Graham, President Eisenhower was baptized into the Presbyterian Church by Reverend Edward Ensign. Eisenhower was a regnant Cold War voice, and he appointed fellow Presbyterian John Foster Dulles as his Secretary of State to further craft America's Cold War strategy. Ensign's beliefs influenced Eisenhower and consequently America's anti-communist stance. Just a few months after Eisenhower's inauguration, Ensign recommended that Eisenhower form what he called a White House conference on moral and spiritual recovery. The idea was to charge this body with inculcating basic American convictions within our people in order to strengthen character and launch a spiritual counteroffensive to communism. A similar coalition was actually formed as a result, and it was run by Ensign. Eisenhower instituted several national days of prayer, demonstrating his stated attitude that deistic faith was essential to Americanism. And on occasion, he incorporated Christians living behind the Iron Curtain in those days of prayer with the aim of praying for freedom from the constructs of men. So he also was credited with the addition of the phrase under God to the Pledge of Allegiance, which was inspired by a Presbyterian Reverend, George M. Doherty. And that Reverend pointed out the similarity of the American Pledge of Allegiance to the stated beliefs of the Soviet Union. He noted that without any statement of faith, communists could recite the American Pledge to a communist flag. And so, as Herzog asserts in the Spiritual Industrial Complex, Eisenhower's efforts contributed to the resurgence of Christian faith in the 1950s and to the sacralization of American government, and recognized the centrality of religiosity to national security and well-being. He believed that only through devout faith, Eisenhower believed, could the Red Menace be defeated. Eisenhower inherited an anti-communist atmosphere in general that had been fueled by McCarthyism in the late 1940s and early 1950s. The Presbyterian Church was a target of McCarthyist witch hunts itself on several occasions, accused of having communist infiltration in the leadership. And as a result, in 1953, the PCUSA sent a letter to its membership. Reverend Glenn W. Moore was a prominent pastor who served as general secretary of the PCUSA, and its chairman was the influential longtime president of Princeton Theological Seminary, John Mackey. And in their 1953 letter, the two leaders outlined the two main threats to America. First, the menace of communism, and second, the fanatical negativism that resulted from the communist threat. The church warned about a spiritual vacuum, explaining that, quote, our national house cleansed of one demon would invite by its very emptiness the entrance of seven others. In the case of a national crisis, this emptiness could, in the high-sounding name of security, be occupied with ease by a fascist tyranny. They encouraged the hatred of the communist ideology, but they also warned that people should guard themselves against hating individuals or the nations as a whole. The strong sense of anti-communism as well as anti-McCarthyism demonstrate a profound understanding of Christianity in those two men, not only in theory, but in the embodiment of it. The attitude pervaded much of the Presbyterian thought of the day, along with many other denominations, but not all Presbyterians aligned their rhetoric to match this. One of them during the same time frame was John Foster Dulles. His impact on Cold War strategy played an important role in Presbyterian anti-communism. He was a former chair of the Federal Council of Churches Commission on a Just and Durable Peace, and he became Eisenhower's Secretary of State in 1953. Mark Toulouse, in his article, The Development of a Cold Warrior, argues that Dulles's Presbyterian and Calvinist ideology crucially impacted his perspective on the Soviet Union and the threat of communism. And Dulles was a noted moralist and adamant supporter of spiritual revival in the post-war period. He was known for his religio-political stances and often turned to scripture to make his ideological appeals to the American people. In his rhetoric, he characterized the United States as the Christian protectors of the rest of the world, which was under attack by Russian godless communism, justifying international intervention with Christian principles. In one instance, he wrote a United States which could be an inactive spectator while the barbarians overran and desecrated the cradle of our Christian civilization would not be the kind of United States which could defend itself. This universalization justified involvement in Korea and other locales to defend the Third World from communist domination. Toulouse argues that Dulles's familiarity with faith, more than a devout belief, served as a rationale for his already existing worldview, instead of his beliefs guiding his actions. And for example, a 1955 decision to use the military to defend Taiwan against Chinese takeover, it stirred up Presbyterian debate. Eugene Carson Blake, who we'll talk about next, and John Mackay, who we've talked about, and a Presbyterian missionary, L. Nelson Bell, objected to the decision. They wrote letters to John Foster Dulles. Blake called for peaceful tactics like negotiation. Mackay characterized the decision as a crime of the first magnitude, and Bell wrote a letter to Eisenhower and Dulles explaining that there are many Christians and many Presbyterians who most heartily disagree with their approach. Despite all of that Presbyterian ministerial advice, Dulles, reproachment, Dulles remained deeply entwined in the church, and he had a very influential voice within it. Eugene Carson Blake was a Presbyterian minister who served as the president of the National Council of Churches, as well as general secretary of the World Council of Churches. He was well acquainted with global communism and had traveled to the Soviet Union in 1956, which is pictured here. His expertise earned him a voice with regard to foreign policy topics like the one we just discussed, and it earned him an invitation to deliver a speech at the Los Angeles Presbytery in 1961 on the church and communism. His speech centered on the concept of, quote, the big lie of communism and the concerns surrounding vigilante anti-communists, inadvertently playing into communist hands. At the time, many Protestant churches were accused of being infiltrated by communists, and he cautioned against going on the defense. Instead, churches, according to Blake, should fight to protect the United States from the anti-communists who could truly destroy American freedom in defense against communism. The speech clearly demonstrates Blake's stance that communism is a great threat, but that it brings with it an internal threat, one that would diminish the freedom of Americans, similarly to the way communism had done to its constituents. Overall, within the PCUSA, there's variation in perspectives on how to handle the Red Menace, both at home and abroad, but there's a common demarcation between ideology, nation states, and individuals that belies those prominent perspectives. Blake, Mackey, Moore, Bell, and Ensign, they all echo each other's rhetoric regarding the spirituality of the American people to guard themselves against atheistic ideology, against hatred, and to denounce McCarthyism as a step towards fascism. But Dulles and Eisenhower, because of their roles in the government, embody a different struggle, the difference between making military strategy decisions to combat the spread of an evil regime and ideology. But they also were looking to inspire a solid faith among Americans to combat the infiltration of communist beliefs on the domestic front. So the question of whether or not individuals, churches, and states should fight against communism was addressed a lot more by the Orthodox Presbyterian Church, especially in their Presbyterian Guardian, a magazine. The Orthodox Presbyterian Church was founded in 1936 and landed on the fundamentalist side of the fundamentalist modernist controversy, lending it a more conservative perspective. The OPC disseminated a monthly magazine named Presbyterian Guardian, which recounted news stories and included essays written by clergy and other prominent figures. Reverend John P. Cleland was the pastor of Westminster Orthodox Presbyterian Church in Georgia, and he served as a contributing editor for the Orthodox, for the Presbyterian Guardian throughout the 1940s. He wrote an article in 1947 called "Should the Church Fight Communism?" He draws clear distinctions between Christian and communist ideology. He asserts that the Christian must oppose and hate and fight communism, but discusses the question of whether the church should fight communism. He answers the question by saying, yes, the church should fight communism, but continues to describe that the church should only fight with spiritual weapons. He criticizes the American Council of Christian Churches for voting to urge aid for nationalists in China and for supporting maintaining troops in Greece. He denounced the militarism related to those religious takes, and this attitude toward communism demonstrates a perspective that delineates the limits of the church and encourages action by the state. He argues that the federal government should take action while criticizing those churches and religious entities for interfering with foreign politics. Unlike Dulles and Eisenhower, Cleland argues that religious entities should, quote, stop trying to make our federal government an instrument for the propagation of Christianity, noting the difference between coercion and persuasion. The language reflects that of Earl Browder, actually, in his discussion of systems of coercion, and demonstrates Blake's concern also that fascism could easily sweep in if America were to become infected with vigilantism. So instead, Cleland stresses the separation of Christian compassion from political negotiation, which he also asserts in another article called Religion at the Peace Table. Another prominent voice featured regularly in the Presbyterian Guardian was that of Francis E. Mahaffey, a longtime missionary to different regions in Africa on behalf of the OPC. He served in both Ethiopia and Eritrea, which the Soviet Union hoped to incorporate into its broader sphere of influence. And from that perspective, he wrote a lot of articles on socialism, communism, political and religious freedom. In 1956, he wrote an article called The State and Christian Morality. Mahaffey takes an admittedly controversial stance, comparing American taxation and the expenditure of taxes to the condoned robbery of socialism communism, asking if it is, quote, not a form of anti-Christian socialistic stealing. He continues to explain that the law of God teaches thrift and frugality and explains the sinfulness of Marxist economic principles. In another article called Christianity versus Socialism, Mahaffey breaks down the ideology of Marxist socialism and compares it with communism, which he regarded with more vitriol than socialism more broadly. To simplify that evaluation, he denotes several commandments from the Bible that socialism breaks in its fundamental ideals. His perspective steers clear of demonizing any of communism's adherents or even making the connection between the Soviet Union and socialist ideology, but he clearly demonstrates to Presbyterian readers that the ideology is abhorrent and violates God's law. He, compared to others writing at the time or preaching, he takes a more educational approach to the steering of religious attitudes, and it demonstrates that those attitudes have the same notion that the ideology is fundamentally incompatible with Christianity, and that he charges both the church and individual Christians to, quote, speak and to speak clearly against this form of violation of God's law. Someone who takes it further is Carl McIntyre. Carl McIntyre, this is moving on to the Bible Presbyterian Church here. Carl McIntyre was a minister in the Bible Presbyterian Church, and he served as the president of the International Council of Christian Churches and the American Council of Christian Churches, lots of councils. He delivered many sermons and speeches on the radio, published articles, and wrote pamphlets for dissemination on important topics. He was one of the most adamant anti-communist organizers, and he coordinated anti-communist rallies throughout the 1950s, which you can see here. He was unique in also including non-Christian anti-communists in those rallies. They weren't entirely religious. McIntyre was clearly passionate about the Red Threat, and in a pamphlet entitled Why Christians Should Fight Communism, he begins by sharing a question submitted to him from Santa Barbara, California, where the inquirer believed that they had been misguided to, quote, not oppose communism, but just preach the gospel. And so McIntyre, known for his demonization of communism and its adherents, immediately rebukes this notion and continues to explain why Christians should fight communism. He demonstrates similar references to scripture as Mahaffey did in his article, but he inserts evocative commentary about communist denial of man's soul, communism's construct of total slavery, the work of the devil, and the Antichrist. Much of McIntyre's rhetoric aligns with other Presbyterian perspectives on the Christian fight against communism, but he takes it a step further. And different than from what Cleland advocates, he calls Christians to strong action and nations to strong action, saying the Christian is and must be the most valiant warrior against godless communism in the 20th century and should lead the fight to win the Cold War and should do so in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel. Marku Ruotsila, I probably butchered that name, but he wrote in Fighting Fundamentalist, a biography on McIntyre, that McIntyre's attitudes toward communism included beliefs about communist infiltration in the church. And he was an example. McIntyre was an example of the hypervigilance that Blake, Mackey, and Moore warned against. McIntyre believed that the Revised Standard Bible even reinforced communistic principles, that the Hungarian clergy that were welcomed into the U.S. when they were persecuted in the Eastern Bloc, that they were also a threat to American Christianity, that the civil rights movement was inextricably associated with communism and its revolutionaries, which also constituted a threat to American Christianity. McIntyre was the founder of the Orthodox Presbyterian Church, which published the Presbyterian Guardian, but he also founded these breakaway churches every time his beliefs differed a little bit. And so that's where he began the Bible Presbyterian Church. His voice on anti-communism also demonstrates the same kind of derivation that he took from the mainline OPC, and McIntyre's transition through each subdenomination that he created, like the Columbus Synod, shows further and further the way that he became more conservative and more fundamentalist over time. He even condemned other televangelists and politicians for being hopelessly liberal and soft on communism, and would likely have proclaimed the same about many of his Presbyterian brethren. So overall, each subdenomination that I looked at so far had a unique voice when it came to Cold War anti-communism, and so did each individual, but a few tenets threaded throughout every attitude. Firstly, each individual derided communism for its atheism. Some cited scripture to further condemn the beliefs of communists, while others took a more broadly philosophical approach. With the exception of Carl McIntyre, there was a prevailing sense that communists and socialists were merely misguided believers to be redirected when shown God's love and mercy, despite the sins of communism as a whole. But some Presbyterians were so compassionate as to argue that Christians should not hate communist countries either. That compassion was understood by some to demonstrate that liberalism that Carl McIntyre spoke out against. But other clergy believed that it was more demonstrative of Jesus's more communistic teachings. Secondly, each of the Presbyterian perspectives encouraged Christians to fight communism both at home and abroad. Some, like Cleland, argued that the fight should only be fought with spiritual weapons. Others, like Dulles and Eisenhower, found themselves caught between the military and their Christian beliefs. Others, like Carl McIntyre, argued for more action-based Christian war on communism, encouraging vitriolic campaigns against pro-communists, including bystanding Christians, even if they denounced communism. And so above all, each of these influential religious and political leaders advocated that their followers guard their hearts against the penetrating ideology of communism, recognizing that the materialism of communism and the utopian rhetoric of Cold War communism could be persuasive. Presbyterians took every opportunity to warn their flocks and guide their followers down a more righteous and American path. They utilized newspapers, books, rallies, speeches, pamphlets, magazines, radio and television broadcasts, and weekly church services to inculcate their audiences with the threats that communism posed for American freedom and Christian salvation. Unlike Carl McIntyre and in some ways Mahaffey, others also warned against hypervigilance. And McIntyre, on the other hand, believed in McCarthyist principles of flushing out communist infiltration within the church. While the attitudes varied, in an article in the Journal of the Presbyterian Historical Society, Charles Anderson summed it up succinctly, writing that one of the greatest attacks against freedom is the tyranny which has raised its head in the form of dictatorships, and more particularly under the banner of communism. Communism has borrowed the Christian emphasis on human values and has duped millions of people into following the will of the wisp of human welfare into the greatest organization of mass slavery the world has ever known. Communism is Christianity's great challenge. We need to make sure that in our fear of communism, we do not adopt measures that deny our freedom, for which our forefathers paid so dearly. Let us hope that as Russia comes into contact with the Christian influence of America, she will learn that there could be no permanent relationships between nations without integrity and justice, like which likewise stem from his faith in God and his sense of responsibility to God Almighty. For me, next steps in researching, I've only covered a few so far of these denominations, and so I hope to take on the remainder of them, the Presbyterian Church in America, the PCA, the Evangelical Presbyterian Church, and then some smaller offshoots like the Cumberland Presbyterian Church and some of the Reformed denominations too. So there's still more work to do, but so far here I was able to span a good range and gather a few of those prevailing ideas. Thanks.